Great to see you on this Labor Day weekend. Anybody here for the last holiday weekend of the year visiting our great city here in North Myrtle Beach, huh? Come on, let's give them a hand clap. Glad you're here. Fantastic. We want to welcome our Whiteville campus. Let's give our Whiteville campus a big hand clap now. All right. We are glad you're here. Next weekend, we'll move into a new teaching series here at Barefoot Church called Warrior. But on Labor Day weekend, I love to do kind of a standalone message and really kind of just remind us of what the church is all about, remind us of the incredible things that God has in store for us. And so we're glad you're here today. I believe that God's going to encourage you in a great way. I believe he's going to motivate you. I believe he is going to really inspire you to do great, great things in your life. A lot of things going on this weekend. You know, last service, I tried to wear this shirt all of services this weekend, but it got a little sweaty last service. And the reason I wanted to wear it is because it's red and I got on black pants. And, you know, that really represents something great on a weekend like this weekend. Georgia Bulldogs, come on, somebody. Huh? Come on. I know there's some of them Gamecock fans in the house and some of them, yeah, them that orange team up there, whatever they are, in the house. And, you know, I know there's the Ohio State fans and little NC State fans. And look at y'all. Let's celebrate Jesus. Come on, somebody. Incredible. It is like college football kickoff and stuff. And Georgia did win yesterday, 51 to something. I don't even know. I thought it was a football game, but it's more like a basketball game. But anyway, they scored a lot of points, and it was phenomenal. You know, on Labor Day weekend, I like to remind us of what this holiday weekend is all about. And then It's an amazing weekend, and some of us think it's just a day that we kind of hang out and eat a little watermelon and, you know, have a barbecue and go to the beach. But, you know, this is a national holiday. And not only is it a national holiday, Labor Day is celebrated around the world in many countries. Now, not always on the first Monday of September. I think it is also celebrated the first Monday in September in Canada. But around the world, it is celebrated, and here in America, you know, America, right? That's how they say it today. It's amazing. But here in America, okay, we celebrate Labor Day for this reason. And I looked this up actually last year, wrote the definition in my journal. And I just want to share it with you again this weekend. Labor Day is a day that we celebrate and rest. We rest and we celebrate the American labor movement. And it is dedicated to the social and economic achievements of workers. It is a yearly national tribute to the contributions workers have made to the strength, prosperity, and well-being of the country. Any workers out there today? Huh? Yeah. So you're off this weekend to celebrate. You know what? The labor that has already been produced. And we can look forward to doing great, great things, and amazing things can happen. So, you know what? If you're a student and you want to know why you're out of school on Monday, it's because, you know what? You're celebrating the labor that has been produced. If you're off of work and your boss was so generous to let you have this long holiday weekend, it's because of the labor that's been produced. It's a great weekend to celebrate. We're going to be watching ball games and going to the beach and going to the swimming pool and having the barbecues. Anybody eating barbecue something tomorrow? Ribs, pork chops, something, huh? Yeah, we like to eat on Labor Day and then spend the rest of our time, you know, trying to get it off the rest of the week or the rest of the year. So, but you know, this week, it was Thursday night late, and as I was preparing for this weekend's message, I created a little photo, an Instagram, a Twitter, a Facebook, and I put it up on my social media account because I wanted us to see this weekend. And I think this right here, this is kind of what we're going to talk about today. But I wrote it this way. Labor Day for humanity happened on one of these. On a cross. Man, you know what? That's something, church, to rest in, and that's something, church, to celebrate. The labor has been produced. The labor has been produced for humanity to enter into a relationship with our great God and look forward to the great kingdom that is yet to come. And you know what? And so as a church, as Christ followers, we have something amazing to celebrate that is so much more than just a holiday on the first Monday of September. We can celebrate this all our life. And you know what? When we come together as a church family, I always want to encourage you in these two facts. Labor has already been produced for you, and you have an opportunity to produce for what is yet to come. And you know, God is an amazing God. He is a great God. We're going to look at a passage of scripture today, and it's found in Matthew 19. If you have your Bibles with you, and it's where Jesus has an encounter with a man. And we're going to talk a little bit about this today. We're resting in the labor already produced. And then, you know what we are to do with our life as we rest in that labor already produced. Because it really does matter. And when Jesus talked to this man in Matthew 19, he reveals a lot of things to us. But in order to set Jesus up properly for the context of the conversation with the man, I want to talk a little bit about who the Bible explains Jesus was before this conversation. And I really want to set him up because Jesus was amazing. And there was some things that he said that really upset all kinds of people. Good, bad, you know, just all kinds of people. Because when Jesus dropped in to the part of the world that he dropped into, he dropped into the middle of a world religion called Judaism. And there wasn't any difference between Judaism and many other world religions. Because all world religions basically teach a principle that is the same. But what Jesus came to talk about was something totally opposite of what every world religion up to that point and since that point has ever taught. And what world religions teach and have in common, and there's different nuances and all kinds of pieces of the puzzle, but they basically all say, you know what, you've got to do something. Do good, work hard, live right, get rid of the bad people, whatever it is, you know what, you've got to do these things in order to enter into eternal life and experience eternal life. I mean, some world religions teach this, do good as the human you are today, and you know what, you're going to come back as a better human or something, okay? There are world religions that teach that, but it's about what you do. You know what? There's world religions that teach, you know what, that you need to kill the bad people. And you think, well, that's terrible, but they're just doing what they think is right. They're just doing what they think is good. And it's to get rid of certain kinds of people. So they're doing what their religion teaches them. And can I tell you something? There's a lot of people that sit in churches and would profess to themselves or profess to the world that they are Christians and they believe the same thing. Do good, do more. You know what? Give more. And what I do really matters. If there's a lot of people, if you ask them, they sit in churches, what must you do to get into heaven, they would say, well, if I if I just keep the commandments, then God's going to let me in. Did you know that God's word never says that God created the Ten Commandments for you to enter the kingdom of heaven? Yeah, this is exactly what got Jesus crucified, executed, nailed to a cross. Because this is the message that he came to bring. And there were some do-gooders, professional do-gooders, in the context of where he dropped into the world. And they believed that if you kept the commandments that and you did good, that God was going to receive you into his eternal kingdom. As a matter of fact, they were such do-gooders that they created hundreds of more rules in order to make sure that they wasn't breaking the rules. I mean, they're good people, man. I'm talking about from a human angle, they're awesome. They're the best of the best. I mean, I want you right now to think of the best person you know. Maybe your wife. Maybe your husband. I mean, my wife thinks I'm the best person in the world. Maybe your children. I mean, maybe somebody. Maybe for you, it's a figure like, you know, a person that's lived a long, long time ago. Maybe it's Mother Teresa. And these people that Jesus dropped into that he upset so much were better than that person that you can think of. And this is what got Jesus crucified. This is what got him put on a cross. It's because he came to teach something that is totally opposite of what every other world religion teaches. And I want to talk a little bit about that today. But to kind of set this up, I want to share with you a little story that comes out of this little small book. I would encourage you to get this book. It's by a pastor out of Atlanta, Georgia, named Andy Stanley. He pastors a church called North Point Church. And the name of the book is How Good Is Good Enough. And it's a little short read, a couple hours. Probably buy it on Amazon for $1.99 or something. I had this on my bookshelf. I read it several years ago. But I pulled it back out as I prepared for this message this week because I kind of wanted to brush up on some things out of this little book that are related to the Bible. But you ought to get it sometime and read it. It's a real quick read, and I believe it's a really good book. But I want to share this story because, see, there's a lot of people here today. A lot of people that sit in churches every week that we talk about Jesus, we go to church, we sing worship songs, we give our money, we do all these things. But what are we resting in? What are we depending upon to get us into the kingdom of God? And this little story that Andy Stanley opens this book up with is this. It says, the story is told of a Sunday school teacher whose assignment was to explain to the six-year-olds in his class what someone had to do in order to go to heaven. In an attempt to discover what the kids already believed about the subject, he asked a few questions. If I sold, he says, to these six-year-olds, if I sold my house, my car, and I had a big garage sale, and I gave all my money to the church, would that get me into heaven? No, the children replied. I mean, that's what they said. And he says, well, let me ask you this question. If I cleaned the church every day, I tore out the front lobby. Doesn't say that. I just wanted to add that in. I want you to let you know that we're tearing out the front lobby. If I cleaned the church every day, mowed the yard, and kept everything neat and tidy, would that get me into heaven? Again, the answers from the six-year-olds was no. Well, then he said, how about if I was kind to animals? I was kind to animals and gave candy to all the children and loved my wife. Would that get me into heaven? And again, they all shouted, no. And he says, well, then what will get me into heaven? And a little six-year-old boy on the back row, he stood up and shouted, "You gotta be dead." You know, I don't think this little six-year-old boy in the story understood how theologically correct he really was. Because the Bible speaks a lot about dying to yourself and trusting God and trusting Christ and let him live in you and through you. And this little boy answered this question. And, you know, and it's amazing, but I think across the board, we can ask people the question, and sometimes they can even verbalize the right answer, but the question is, what do you really believe in the core of who you are? And Jesus had a whole lot to say about the kingdom of heaven, of how you enter and what is yet to come in the kingdom. And so to set Jesus upright, I want you to understand, when he came to teach, he got crucified because of what he was teaching. Now, he was sent by God to die on a cross, but because he came in and he was teaching what every other world religion was not teaching, including Judaism, the people, the law keepers, the Jewish law keepers were very upset with him. And I want to give you three reasons that people were so upset with Jesus, and it still makes people upset today. But the reason is Jesus gave this amazing message, this amazing talk, this amazing sermon. Many people refer to it as the Sermon on the Mount, the talk on the hill, the greatest speech ever given to humanity. And it's found in your Bible, in Matthew, from Matthew 5 to Matthew 7. And as Jesus is talking there, he says something that begins to really upset the apple cart and make people very upset. He says, unless your righteousness is better than the righteousness of the teachers of the religious law and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, keep in mind, there were teachers of the law and Pharisees in this crowd where Jesus is talking. And so basically what Jesus just told them, and they were good people. I'm talking about they were the Mother Teresas of the world of that day. They knew God's law. They kept God's law. They did everything. They made up other rules, some 600 and some odd other rules to make sure that it wasn't breaking the rules, the Ten Commandments. And then Jesus basically, when he says this, because he says, unless it is better than their law keeping, then you can't enter the kingdom of heaven. So he just told them people who were good people that you're not good enough. Now, I don't know about you, but if I'd spent my whole life learning all of this, these rules and this regulation, what not to do, what to do, I was keeping it, I was striving hard, I was teaching it, I was going around the world, you know, and I was doing the best I knew how to do because I wanted to enter the kingdom of heaven, and I was teaching all of this stuff. If Jesus came up and says, hey, you know what, you're A+, ain't good enough, I'd be upset. And believe me, they were highly upset with Jesus because they were teaching, do this and enter the kingdom of heaven. Again, let me be crystal clear. God's word never says the law was for you to enter the kingdom of heaven. When Moses sketched it out on a stone in the book of Exodus, when God gave it, go check it out. God didn't say, I'm giving this for you to enter the kingdom of heaven. But I can tell you right now, there's churches today that are constantly teaching, if you do these things, then God's going to be pleased with you and let you into the kingdom of heaven. And I am telling you today, Jesus came to teach exactly the opposite. He's like, what you do ain't good enough. What? Second thing that made everybody mad. And so I just want you to, that first thing, think about this. So if I'm in the culture and Jesus basically says, what the law keepers, what the Mother Teresa's of the world is doing is not good enough. And I look at myself, then, you know, if I'm them, I'm mad because I'm not good enough. And then if I am not them and I'm in the culture, I'm like, dude, these people are professional do-gooders. And I look at myself and I'm like, well, heck, if they can't get in, then surely I can't get in. And I'm really sad. So he made people mad. He made people sad. But in the same breath and in the same, out of the, you know, in the same time period when Jesus was walking the face of the earth, he told the good people, you can't be good enough. And then he would turn to really wayward people doing really bad stuff. Breaking God's laws, breaking the Ten Commandments. And he would turn to them and say, your sins are forgiven. What? Jesus, what I'm doing ain't good enough to get in the kingdom of heaven. And you turn to that guy who is, you know, sleeping around on his wife, that woman who's had, you know, committing adultery every other week, and you tell her, her sins are forgiven? What? Now, I know. If you were God, there would be some people you wouldn't let in. And I know if I was God, there would be some people I wouldn't let in. But I want you to think about, this is what got him nailed to a cross. Because it'd be like, you know, he looks at me and says, I'm a moral good citizen. I'm doing all the things right. And he says, you're not good enough. But hey, this guy over here that slapped your mama last week, your sins are forgiven. Again, this is what got him crucified. Because he was going around saying, you can't be good enough. He's saying, but your bad can't keep you out either. And then just to be clear, in that same sermon where Jesus, what we call the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, because remember, there's Pharisees, there's people who thought they were getting it right, standing in the crowd. And Jesus just wanted to make it crystal clear to them that, you know what, that they had interpreted the law of Moses wrong. So what he said was stuff like this. You say, or you've heard from the law of Moses, that thou shalt not commit adultery. He says, but let me raise the bar. Because everybody in the crowd, the Pharisees, the great do-gooders, were like, that's right. We ain't done that. And Jesus will look at my eye and say, but I say, if you've ever looked at a woman lustfully, you've committed adultery in your heart. Now, I don't know about you, but I might have been doing good and not sleeping around on my wife. But once he upped the ante, and I'm a man, and I'm created to look at women, come on, somebody. And he tells me that if you've ever looked at a woman lustfully, I know you're all spiritual, then you've broke the law, you've committed adultery in your heart. Man, that makes me mad. Oh, where's Jesus? You're telling me I can't get, you just raised the bar. And then he would look at him and say, I'm talking about the do-gooders, because he wanted them to understand something. He wasn't doing it to condemn them. He was doing it to show them something. They had misinterpreted what the law of Moses was all about. It was never created for them to do good. It was created for them to see a problem. And so Jesus would say, hey, you've heard the law of Moses says, do not murder. And they're like, hey, I hadn't done that. I'm good. Jesus says, well, if you got angry at that guy, then you already committed murder in your heart. I don't know about you, but when I check my heart, I have to believe, I get angry when they don't, my staff don't act right. And see, we can all sit here and look at it and say, hey, I checked it off. I do good. I'm awesome. I keep this rule. I live good in this culture. I don't break the law. I don't do this. And God would look at you in the eye and he would always raise the ante for you to see something. That you're depending on what you do instead of the labor he produces. This is Jesus. This is the Jesus of the Bible. This is the one that came and said the opposite thing from what every world religion says. Do something to enter the kingdom of heaven. Do. So I got to ask you, why do you do anything good? I'm going to share with you in a minute the reason you should want to do something good. Jesus is going to reveal that to us. But I want you just to examine your own heart right now. And even why do you come to church? Why do you come to a weekend service? Why do you give money in the offering bucket? Why are you nice to people? Why do you begin to memorize your Bible? What are you doing good? And why are you doing it? And by the way, what is the definition of good? Because I can tell you right now, there's some people that are part of other world religions outside of Christianity, and what they're doing, we may think it's bad, but they think it's good. So why are you doing good? Why would you even strive to keep the commandments? Another guy, his name is Paul. He wrote much of the New Testament in our Bible. He wrote letters to churches. And this particular letter that he wrote to a church is called Romans. He wrote to the church at Rome. And I want to show you what it says. Romans 3:20, it says this. He says it this way. For no one can ever be made right with God by doing what the law commands. The law simply shows us how sinful we are. So what he says here to the church at Rome is the law was never intended, you know what, to make you right with God. It was to show you something that you needed something else to make you right with God. Oh, I know it shakes your world. Because there's a lot of people who would call themselves Christians to say, no, man, I got to do this. It is not due. The labor has already been produced. In that same letter in Romans chapter 7, he says it this way. He says, am I suggesting that the law of God is sinful? He said, of course not. In other words, the law of God is not a bad thing, people. It's awesome. And you know what? You should try to follow it with all of your heart, but you need to understand it was never designed for you to get into the kingdom of heaven. The Bible makes it crystal clear. And it goes on to say, He says, of course not. It's not sinful. In fact, it was the law. It was the law that showed me my sin, showed me I had missed the mark of God's glorious standard. He said, how in the world would I have ever known that, you know what, wanting somebody else's Corvette was wrong? Oh, he says, he didn't say that. He says, I would never have known that coveting is wrong if the law had not said you must not covet. Have you ever coveted anything? How do you know it's coveting? I mean, I thought I was supposed to want what they have. And again, it's not that you don't strive not to covet, but you need to understand without the law, you would never know that there was something wrong with you, and what you needed to do was depend upon something other than what you do to get you into the kingdom of heaven. Don't miss this. Hebrews 11:6 says, it is impossible to please God without faith. Anyone who wants to come to him must believe that God exists and that he rewards those who sincerely seek him. So I got two questions for you. Do you believe that God rewards people, and do you believe that he exists? And if he does exist and he does reward, how do you get those rewards, and what do you believe about his existence? Again, many people think, do good. If God is good, then I do good. And that's how I get in. He will accept me if I do good. You know, it's interesting. At my house, we're always trying to lose weight. Anybody else do that? I know, Tuesday, you'll be trying to lose weight after you eat all that barbecue. But we're always trying to lose weight. And I think it was Saturday morning. My wife walks into the bathroom where we get on a set of these and, you know, periodically check how we doing. You know what I'm saying? And she is like, she's mad at the scales. I said, why are you mad at the scales? You Pharisee? No. She's like, because, you know, those things, those numbers, they're saying that I'm heavier than I think I am. And she said, I can't believe they're saying that. I cannot believe that, you know what, those numbers, I'm not going to tell you what the numbers are registering that. And I'm like, why are you mad at the scales? Scales are awesome. They're showing you got a problem. And it ain't the scale's fault. Matter of fact, the scales are an awesome tool because they're showing you got a problem. It's called Cheerios and Captain Crunch and what do you call it? Fruity Pebbles at 10:30, 11 o'clock every night before you go to bed. It's called Red Velvet Cake. And the scales, the law didn't make you put that red velvet cake down your throat. It just revealed what you already have done. So why be upset with it? It's a good thing because it's revealing the truth. And see, this is all Jesus is doing. He's saying the law is like a mirror. Friends, it was always to show us that we have a problem and we need something outside of ourselves to help us with our problem. It's called a sin problem. And you know what? I don't care how many times you stand on the scale. I don't care how many times you try to make the scale change you. It can't change you. But there's one that came to change your position, and his name is Jesus, and change everything about your life. The law can't make you right with God. It can only show you that you need God. This is the good news. No one has ever been made right by the law. The labor has already been produced. And so now, real quickly, I'll teach through the passage that we've got Jesus set up properly. Because Jesus came to teach. It's about forgiveness and trust. Not what you do. And so Jesus has this encounter with a do-gooder, a man who came to him. And the Bible says this, Matthew 19, beginning with verse 16. Someone came to Jesus with this question, and it may be your question today. Maybe you don't verbalize it this exact way, but maybe you got the same question. Teacher, he saw Jesus as a teacher. He says, what good deed must I do to have eternal life? What good deed must I do? Must I do? And he says, what good deed must I do? And Jesus responds kind of radically. He says, why ask me about what is good? There's only one who is good. In other words, sir, your definition of good is way off base. Because if you're measuring good, there's only one that's good. And it's the creator of the universe, and everything else is defiled by this thing called sin. And so if you think for a moment, I just want to give you a glimpse of eternity. Where we're living now is good. No matter what you have, no matter where you are, you don't have a proper understanding of the kingdom yet to come. And yeah, many of us have nice things. It's awesome or whatever else. But compared to what is yet to come, my friends, it is not good. Get a glimpse of who God is. Because, see, Jesus didn't only come as a suffering servant. The Bible reveals him in a book called Revelation as the King of Kings. And that whole book is about the kingdom that is yet to be established, about the new world and what it's all going to be about. And the Bible wants to give us a clear picture that there's greater days ahead of us. There's greater things to come. But there's one way in, and it's not by what you do. A lot of people would say Christianity is exclusive. It's not fair. No, I would say that Jesus is the great equalizer, and he makes it crystal clear, and it's fair for everybody because everybody gets in the same way. Jesus says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. But Jesus said, to answer your question, sir, if you want to receive eternal life, keep the commandments. Well, preacher, I thought you just said that keeping the commandments couldn't get you into eternal life. I did. Contextually understand what Jesus is saying. Sir, you're depending on what you do. And I want to make it crystal clear that what you do don't get you in. And as he said to the Pharisees, you think that you're keeping the commandments, but let me raise the bar. He's revealing something to this man's heart, and he's revealing something to everybody else around him. It's not what you do. It's what's already been done. And so he tells the man, hey, keep the commandments. And the man's a do-gooder. He's like, awesome, man. I can do this. So the man says, which one? Is it the 10, Jesus? Is it the 600 and some odd? I mean, I'm a good guy. And Jesus says, well, here's the ones. You must not murder. You must not commit adultery. You must not steal. You must not testify falsely. Honor your father and mother. Love your neighbor as yourself. And the man says, well, I got all those. I've obeyed all of these commandments. The young man replied, what else must I do? And Jesus is like, the guy has misinterpreted what the law of Moses is all about. He thinks it's a checklist that he can do instead of seeing it as a mirror to reflect that he needs dependency on me. And though Jesus says, keep the commandments, when he says keep the commandments, he knows that there's no person able to keep the commandments. And that's why he ups the ante in Matthew 5. And it's why he looks at this man. But the man's like, I'm doing that. So Jesus is like, let me up the ante for you. I'm going to give you something that you can't do. And so Jesus told him, well, if you want to be perfect, go and sell your possessions, all your possessions, and give your money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me. So does that mean that for me to get into heaven, I got to go give all my money to the poor people and live in a tent? And now God's going to let me in heaven because I give all my money to the poor? No. See, you got to understand what Jesus is doing. He's revealing over and over and over to people, listen, you're trusting what every world religion in the world trusts. And I came to teach you just the opposite. Without faith in a God who will do something for you, you know what? You will never enter the kingdom of heaven. And so Jesus challenges this man to take his stuff, give it to the poor, because Jesus knew it wasn't something that he could do, you know, in his own power, in his own strength. And so the Bible says this, but when the young man heard this, he went away sad, for he had many possessions. Does God hate rich people? Does God not want you to have anything? Can rich people not go to heaven? No. If I got stuff, should I give it all away? No, can I tell you what the Bible says if you got stuff you should do? Steward it and leverage it for something greater. I'll get to that in a minute. So Jesus challenges this man, listen, you know what? If you want to do something, do. He says, let me give you something you can't do because you need to see that, you know what? Life, eternity is not dependent upon you. It's dependent upon me. This is hard for us to get. The reason is because every world religion before Jesus came and after Jesus came, they teach that, you know what? Good people get into heaven, bad people don't. And Jesus came to say, no, I came to level the playing field. Forgiven people that believe in me get into heaven. Bible says, after that encounter, Jesus turned to his disciples, the students that are standing with him. As they're all gazing at what he just said, he says, I tell you the truth, it is very hard for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven. He says, I'll say it again. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven. Why? Can I tell you why? Because if you have stuff in this life, you'll begin to put your faith in the stuff in this life, and you'll begin to not realize that you need to put your dependency in something else, and you'll depend upon something of this world that will not last forever. And Jesus is like, so if you've got stuff in this world, it's really easy for you to put your dependency in what you're producing instead of what I'm going to produce on a cross. It's really easy to be satisfied in this world We live in a blessed country, an amazing place, and it's really easy to get satisfied with the things of this earth. But compared to the kingdom that God is building and what is yet to come, man, it is only a shadow, and it is defiled by this thing called sin. There is things all in this world, and as perfect as you may think it is not the final kingdom. So Jesus is basically saying, don't cling to relationships here. Don't cling to your stuff. Don't cling to the law. Don't cling to your Bible study. Did you know that there's people that sit in churches every week? They know their Bible inside and out, supposedly with their head. They know where to look up every verse, and they know all about it. And they're like, God's going to let me in because I know so much. And God's going to say to them, you know what? No, you know so much about your Bible, but I never knew you. Because you didn't realize your Bible was teaching you to depend upon me and not yourself. God loves rich people. God loves poor people. God loves women. God loves men. God loves boys. God loves girls. God loves people who go to Christian churches. God loves people who are from the Islam faith. God loves people from Buddhism. God loves people from every world religion. That's why he came to say, hey, all of you world religions out there that's doing all of this stuff to get to me, he says, I want to come show you that, you know what, it's not dependent on what you do. It's dependent on my grace, my mercy, and my love, and it's why I'm going to come in the form of a human, and I'm going to die on a cross because I came to make it all equal, to level the playing field, and what I need you to do is put your faith in who I am, God saying, instead of what you do, what religion you belong to, what church you go to, who, what family line you become from, because it's never been about that. It's about my love, my grace, and my mercy, and would you rest and depend upon me? And may God shake your world today. If you think that for 1 minute you can produce 1 ounce of good work to enter the kingdom of heaven because of what you do will never get you there. So why give? Why serve? Why go to church? I believed in Jesus. I believed that he died on a cross and resurrected from a grave. That's what my faith is in. I'm in. Why do anything? It's because maybe you've sat in church all your life. And all you've ever thought about is getting in. And God has revealed that there's a greater kingdom yet to come. And Jesus talked about a lot of the rewards in that kingdom. And so you do nothing to get in the kingdom, but you can do everything with what you have in life and steward it and build the kingdom and experience greater rewards in the kingdom yet to come. It's not working to get in, but once you receive the grace, mercy, and love of what Christ did on the cross and believe and put your faith in that great God for eternal life, and you can continually seek God, you'll understand that, you know what, he is building the kingdom. It's not over yet. Yes, Jesus came as a suffering servant, but there was a revelation of him in the book of John, and it shows that, you know what, that he is a risen king, and there's a new world yet to come. And so the disciples were astonished, the Bible says. And they ask a question. Well, this guy is a good guy. And, you know, he's got stuff and all this kind of stuff. Well, if he can't be saved, if a rich person can't be saved, if a good person can't be saved, they ask, well, who can? Don't let that distract you right there for a minute. Okay? He's just getting ready to play here in just a few minutes. And Jesus answers the question. Here it is. They ask, who in the world can be saved? The Bible says Jesus looked at them intently and said, humanly speaking, it is impossible. You can't do anything to be saved. They said, who can be saved? He said, humanly speaking, it is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. You can't do it, humanly speaking. And so Peter speaks up. Peter speaks up. And he said to Jesus, well, we've given up everything to follow you. What will we get? And Jesus replied this. He says, here's the deal. He says, yes, you have trusted in me. You have trusted and put your faith in God, Peter. And he says, I assure you that when the world is made new and the Son of Man sits upon his glorious throne, you who have been my followers will also sit on the 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone who has given up houses or brothers or sisters or fathers or mothers or children or property for my sake, for my kingdom, he says, will receive 100 times as much in return and will inherit eternal life. But many who are the greatest now will be the least important then. And those who seem the least important now will be the greatest then. And so he says here, if you have believed in me, you have trusted and depended upon me for your entrance, everything that you do in life for my sake, for the kingdom's sake, he's not saying you're going to get more tomorrow. He's saying in the new world, in the world yet to come, in the unshakable kingdom, in the kingdom that will outlast all kingdoms, he says there's going to be 100-fold that come back to you that rewards you for what you do with your Christian life since you entered in as a kingdom citizen. You don't do anything to enter, but once you enter, you can take everything, your money, your body, your gifts, your talents, your family. You can take everything and be a kingdom builder and store up treasures for yourself in heaven. And see, we got to understand. And the reality of it is many people think, well, I just get in and I'm going to have a couple of wings and I'm going to fly around in the kingdom in the new world yet to come. And I'm going to be this beautiful little clever angel. No, 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 my friend. The Bible says that you're going to get a brand new body and it's a kingdom. It's a kingdom that God is building and it will last forever. And Jesus talked over and over and over and over and over again about having faith for the reward. What? You have to make up your own mind today. Are you working to get in? Or are you depending upon the labor already produced to get in? And then those of us who are in, are we stewarding what we have in order to build the kingdom? Do I have faith that what is yet to come is going to be greater
than what I'm experiencing now. And you say, well, preacher, are you really sure about this? I'm going to read you one last verse and I'll close the service. Paul wrote this in 1 Corinthians to the church at Corinth, chapter 3. He says, on judgment day, fire will reveal what kind of work each believer has done. It says builder, but you just can substitute the word believer here, because it's those who have already got in is this judgment day. The Bible says the fire will show if a person's work has any value. If the work survives, the builder, the believer, will receive a reward. But if the work is burned, the builder will suffer great loss. So you can get in and suffer great loss. The Bible goes on to say this. It says, the builder will be saved. The believer will be saved, but like someone barely escaping through the wall of flames. So you can get in and not steward your life. You can sit in a seat every week. You cannot think about the kingdom yet to come. And I don't believe there's enough preaching today on the kingdom yet to come to inspire people to get off of their duff and do some stuff. Because, you know, Jesus talked a lot about rewards and talked a lot about building the kingdom. And the reason he did was to motivate us to be kingdom builders, to build the kingdom. You say, well, how do I build the kingdom? Well, Proverbs 11, the wisdom book says, he who winneth souls is a wise person. He who goes out and shares this good news with all people around the world, that Jesus came to make the playing field level, that he came to forgive humanity of their sin. And all we got to do is trust his free gift on a cross, and we can enter the kingdom. And then we can begin to use what we have, our gifts, our talents, and become part of his body, the local church, and begin to share this with the world. Can you imagine what the world would look like if we really believe God? That he forgives sin, and then we can build an eternal kingdom and build our life into that and be rewarded for it. See, I'm just crazy enough to believe that, you know what, that Jesus is who he says he is, and he came to give me salvation. And I'm just crazy enough to believe he talked a whole lot about me stewarding my life and having eternal rewards. I don't see today, I see what is yet to come. I've got eternal eyes. I invite you to have eternal eyes. Get beyond your troubles. Get beyond your challenges. Get beyond your riches. Get beyond your day. Get beyond your family. Because Jesus says, hey, here's the deal. If you give up anything in this life, in the kingdom yet to come, 100-fold's coming to you, baby. But it's going to be measured by fire. Every sermon I've ever preached is going to be measured. Just because I preach the sermon don't mean I'm going to get a reward. But if I preach the sermon for God's name's sake, in Jesus' sake, I'll be rewarded 100-fold. But I can tell you right now, every word that's ever come out of my mouth up here ain't been for the glory of God. Because I'm a human being. And you are too. I invite you to check why you do what you do. If you belong to the church, why give money? Bible says God loves a cheerful giver, not a giver that gives to get in, a giver that gives to build his kingdom, a giver that understands eternity. You see, it's not about doing something so you get into God's kingdom. It's about doing something because of what God has already done, and you have faith that he's building a kingdom that is larger than life and in this world, and you've got faith, and you use your resources, your talents, you invite people, you do all kinds of things. The labor for you to get in has already been produced. However, you can wake up tomorrow and begin to do things for kingdom's sake and store up treasure for yourself in heaven. God, thank you so much today for this message. Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness. And all of these other things will be added unto you as well. God, I don't know where people are today in this place. And God, I don't know why they came today. I don't know why they came to the Whiteville campus. But God, You brought every one of us together today for a purpose. And that purpose is so that we can hear the good news that You came and labored on a cross and died for humanity, for our sin. Jesus, You came to take the sin of the world away, and You resurrected from a grave so we could have a life. And God, if there's a man, a woman, a boy or a girl who have been trusting what they do to enter Your kingdom, I pray today could be the day that they enter Your kingdom by trusting in what Christ has already done on a cross as He labored greatly. And so I don't know where you are today, but I know that the Spirit of God could have been speaking to you today, and you need to reappropriate your faith in God and not in yourself. Maybe you need to reappropriate your faith in what Jesus has done on a cross and not in the good that you are doing. Doesn't mean that you should just go out of here and start doing bad, but what it does mean is that your goodness can't get you into the kingdom of heaven. And so if you've been trusting something other than God Himself, your good merit, your finances that you've been given, your family name, if you've been trusting what you have been doing or not been doing, today is the day that you can trust Christ. You say, well, how do I do that? Again, it's not the words you say, but you can just talk to God and you can pray, because the words can't save you, but your heart belief in Jesus can. And so if that is you today, just right where you sit, I'm not going to embarrass you or anything, but I'd love for you to just to say something like this. God, I'm tired of trying to do life my own way. I'm tired of trying to earn my way into the kingdom. I'm tired of trying to be the do-gooder. And God, I want to receive the gift of salvation that Jesus came to offer on a cross. Tell God, thank You for the gift of grace, mercy, and love that He gave to humanity. Tell Him that's what you want to put your faith in. That's what you want to embrace. And you believe that He resurrected from a grave to give you life, eternal life. And if you said that prayer today, just tell God, thank You, right where you sit. I do believe it's the best decision you've ever made. And me, as a pastor, I'd be greatly encouraged just to know about your decision. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to call you out. In a moment, I'll tell you about a tool I have for you to help you on your journey. But if you made that decision today, in a moment, I'm going to count to three, and I'd love for you just to stick your hand up in the air so I can see that hand. Because, see, maybe God brought you here today so you can rest. Rest in what already has been done and stop depending upon yourself. So if you said that prayer and you trusted Christ today, just simply, when I get to three, put your hand in the air. One, two, three, wherever you are in this auditorium. Praise God, praise God, praise God. Just hold it high. Praise God, man. Front, praise God, sir. Praise God over here. Praise God. Praise God right there, sir. All over this place today. You know what? And again, I'm not going to embarrass you. Amazing. God just sees your hand up in the air. Thanks for giving me that encouragement today. Welcome to the family of God. You can put your hands down. God, You're amazing. And God, I thank You for speaking to people's heart today, and they are saying that they've trusted Christ for their salvation today. God, I pray You continue to build them on the journey. And today we celebrate as the church because of the labor already produced. And God, we're going to keep working with what we have for Your name's sake to build Your kingdom that is yet to come. God, we celebrate today as a church with all of these people who have just joined Your family by faith and trust in who You are. And we close it today in Jesus' name. Amen. Can you give the folks a hand clap today? Hey, we're going to dismiss you here in just a second. And as we prepare to dismiss you, if you did make that decision, I told you about a gift we would love to give you. And so right after we let you go here in a second. If you want to come down to these two front white doors here at this campus, they're in Whiteville. Just make your way up to the front there, and we'll give you this bag that says the best day ever. In here are some tools, tell you a little bit about how to do the journey. There'll be some folks who'd love to talk to you. It's a gift that people have invested in to give you, to equip you for greater things, about a $25 value. Again, we're not asking you to pay for it. We just want to put it in your hand, know about your decision. So there'll be some people on each side down here today to give you that on your way out if you made that decision to follow Christ today. I do want to remind you that we've got our Threads event coming up, our ladies event. And if you'd like to volunteer, there's a table out front on your way out today. And if you absolutely miss the giving today and you want to give to this work and this ministry and worship God, there's drop boxes and kiosks on your way out today too. God bless you. Have a great weekend. Happy Labor Day.